Let's end by verifying the equality of these things. All right, so redraw a picture. Here's V, here's W. But my goal again is to verify that V dot W is the magnitude of V times the magnitude of W times the cosine of the angle between them. I said it depends on the law of cosines, which is a subject in trigonometry. I better make a triangle. It's not a right triangle in general. But if I know this is V and this is W, I can label this side as an arrow. And in fact, it would be the arrow as I've drawn it to be V minus W. What does the law of cosines say? If I label this side C, this side A, and this side B, the law of cosines implies that C squared equals A squared plus B squared, as if it were the Pythagorean theorem, but it's not necessarily a right triangle. So we have to subtract off something that'll make it work even when it's not a right triangle. Turns out to be 2AB cosine of the angle. That is what the law of cosine says. In terms of the vectors, C squared is the same as the magnitude of V minus W squared. A squared is the same as the magnitude of V squared. B squared is the magnitude of B squared. Oops, W. And then we have 2AB cos theta. That's 2 times the magnitude of V times the magnitude of W times the cosine of the angle. Oh, that looks good. Smiley face. That's what we're trying to get to, right, for the dot product. But how do we deal with all this other stuff? Go back to the thing I said 3 minutes ago that's pretty fundamental. That is the same as V minus W dotted with itself. This is the same as V dotted with itself. This is the same as W dotted with itself. That's how we get the dot products in there. Bunch of simplification must happen somehow. The distributive property would allow us to essentially FOIL this to say it's V dot V minus V dot W minus W dot V minus W dot or plus W dot W. First times first. Well, first, dot, outside, inside, dot, inside, last. V dot V, first, outside, inside, dot, inside, last. And guess what? This is all supposed to equal this stuff up here. So we do get some cancellation. This cancels with this. This cancels with that. By the commutative property, this simplifies to minus 2V dot W equals minus 2 times that. We're done. Divide both sides by negative 2. So if we rely on the law of cosines, it's very easy to verify this. Well, maybe not very easy, but relying on the law of cosines and relying on properties of dot products, it's a not too hard verification of this fact. But that just does, that begs a question, two questions. First of all, like, well, why can we FOIL here? Properties of dot products, we'd have to verify that. Maybe a more significant question is, why is the law of cosines work? That's a trigonometry subject. To tell you the truth, I don't remember how it's derived offhand. Probably it's a matter of breaking this triangle up into two right triangles and maybe applying regular right triangle trigonometry and maybe the Pythagorean theorem. That's my guess about how to derive the law of cosines. But I don't remember the details. We're ending early. Should we end early? Let me mention just 3 minutes. We'll end a little early. Where we're headed with all this, that's important to me at least, is thinking about parametric curves, motion in three-dimensional space. So pretend this is a three-dimensional picture of a bug flying or a particle traveling or whatever, an airplane flying through the air. Not only is you have the parametric curve, which is the path itself, but also you've got the changing speed, speed up, slow down, speed up, slow down. We're interested in the speed, which we can integrate to find the distance traveled. We're also really interested in the derivatives of the position vector. Maybe the origin in three-dimensional space is right there. And at any moment in time, you can define a position vector R of t. We could find the velocity vector by differentiating the position vector. We can find the acceleration vector by differentiating the velocity vector. And the acceleration is probably what we're most interested in because of the physics of it. That would be parallel to the force, F equals ma, to the net force. If we could find the acceleration vector, that would be great. The acceleration vector for an arbitrary motion like this is not as simple as like circular motion where it points straight toward the center of the circle. The acceleration vector can be doing lots of wild things as you move. But we can break down the acceleration vector into tangential and normal components. If this red line here is tangent to the curve of motion at a particular moment in time, the acceleration vector is going to have a tangential component and a normal component. And if we can understand those, that'll tell us something about the acceleration vector, some interesting things. Okay, that's where we're headed with all this.